Well, good morning. Thank you all for being here for a briefing on the events from last night. And let me just start off by saying that I'm truly troubled to be here before you now talking about these tragic events that occurred last night in downtown Denver, when instead we should be celebrating an NBA championship win by our Denver Nuggets. Sadly, though, because of this unnecessary instance of gun violence that occurred literally in the midst of thousands of community members who were peacefully celebrating, we have to set that aside for right now. In a moment, you'll hear from Commander Clark, who will describe what we know at this time. But I think it's important to recognize that there were thousands, and I want to thank those thousands of fans that were peacefully celebrating in downtown Denver after the win, and also recognize the officers that you'll see in the video who all ran toward the danger, as they routinely do, placed in the appropriate areas and were able to immediately respond and address those and render aid to those that were injured. So, Matt.
Thanks, Chief. Good afternoon. My name is Matt Clark. I'm the commander of the Major Crimes Division for the Denver Police Department. I appreciate you being here and providing us an opportunity to offer an update to the incident that occurred in the area of 20th and Market early this morning. This is intended to be a preliminary briefing based on the information that we've gathered from interviewing witnesses, speaking to the victims who are available to us at this point, and processing the crime scene out on Market. Obviously, the investigation's in its early stages at this point. There may be information I either do not have or questions I may not be able to answer, but to the degree we are able, we'll take questions at the conclusion. To jump in, on Tuesday, June 13th, 2023, just after 12:30 in the morning, the Denver Police Department had a significant number of officers assigned to the area of 20th and Market Street to monitor the post-game celebration. At that time, the celebration was generally ending. The larger crowds that had previously gathered were beginning to disperse, and there was just several groups left in the area. While monitoring the area, the officers heard a number of shots being fired in the 2000 block of Market Street. They immediately responded to assist and attempt to identify the individuals who were responsible for firing the rounds. Officers located multiple individuals who had been injured by gunfire and began rendering aid until ambulances could arrive. Simultaneously, other Denver police officers located and detained individuals who were believed to be involved in the incident. One individual fled the area on foot and was chased by officers. He was taken into custody near Park Avenue and Blake Street. This individual was found to be suffering from a gunshot wound from the prior incident and was transported to the hospital for treatment. While searching the individual, the officers recovered a firearm and suspected fentanyl pills on him as well. Other officers contacted the occupants of a vehicle that was in the parking lot directly across the street from the View House in the 2000 block of Market Street. The occupants were believed to be involved in the shooting. When they were contacted, the officers located a firearm in the floorboard of the driver's seat. The driver of the vehicle was detained. None of the occupants of the vehicle had gunshot wounds. In total, 10 individuals sustained gunshot wounds in this incident. All were adults, 9 were men. We had one woman injured as well. All were reported to have sustained non-life-threatening injuries, and I'll let the doctors speak more to their injuries. We recognize it's likely that the individuals who were responsible for shooting, discharging the firearms downtown, were also injured by gunfire, and we're continuing to investigate that. And while we know some of the offenders were injured by gunfire, we also know that several innocent people who were in the area were hit by rounds that were fired. Investigators worked throughout the night processing the crime scene. It appears that multiple firearms were discharged and that at least 20 rounds were fired in that area. In addition to the firearm located at the individual on Park Avenue and the vehicle, the one that was found in the vehicle, 3 additional firearms were recovered by investigators. Additional forensic work will be needed to determine if those firearms were discharged at our scene. Crime scene technicians also located a significant quantity of fentanyl pills in the area that were bundled in several baggies. At this point, we have 2 individuals in custody, and they're in custody on weapons-related charges as we continue to determine what their involvement was and what, if any, injuries they caused by the rounds that were fired. The first individual is 22-year-old Ricardo Vasquez. He's being held for investigation of possession of a weapon by a previous offender, as well as possession of a controlled substance. That was the individual arrested at Park Avenue and Blake Street. We also arrested 33-year-old Raul Jones. He's being held for investigation of possession of a weapon by a previous offender, and that's related to the individual who was in the vehicle. And we'll provide all these names and spellings after the briefing. The investigation is ongoing. We've been in regular communication with the Denver District Attorney's Office. And as we better understand the involvement of the individuals, the two that I previously mentioned, as well as anybody else that we identify, additional charges will be pursued if appropriate. Members of the Denver Police Department's Victims Assistance Unit will continue providing support and assistance to the injured victims as they recover. Investigators interviewed multiple witnesses last night, and I appreciate the cooperation and the willingness to provide information by those people who have done so. This will allow us to quickly identify and hold the offenders accountable. I would encourage anyone with information about the incident to contact the Denver Police Department or Metro Denver Crime Stoppers. Crime Stoppers offers an anonymous mechanism to report information to law enforcement, and the phone number for Crime Stoppers is 720-913-STOP. If anybody has video of the incident, we are aware there's multiple videos that are out there at this point. We'd appreciate you providing the raw video footage to the police department so we can analyze it. And you can do that by contacting the police department, and we'll provide a link and a mechanism to upload that to us. At this point, I'd like to turn it over to Gary Bershevitz from the Denver Health Medical Center.
Good morning. I'm Gary Bryskiewicz. I'm the Chief Paramedic for the Denver Health Paramedic Division. I want to first start by saying that our ability to respond so quickly to this was truly due to the collaboration of our public safety partners, the Denver Police Department and the Denver Fire Department, and the pre-planning that went into place to make sure that we had resources available during this event. From the moment shots were fired, we had paramedics on scene rendering care within 1 minute of the call. Over the next several minutes, and through amazing care and coordination of a couple command post centers that we had set up to control these resources, we were able to direct six ambulances in, which transported 10 patients to Denver Health Medical Center. At this point, I'd like to turn over to Denver Health Medical Center Surgeon, Dr. Eric Campion.
Thank you very much. My name is Eric Campion. I'm one of the trauma surgeons at Denver Health Medical Center. And I stand here incredibly disappointed that such a wonderful celebration was marred by gun violence when we should have been celebrating the Denver Nuggets. But I do stand here as well, incredibly proud of the response of both all of our pre-hospital folks, the Denver Police Department, the Denver paramedics, and all of the staff of Denver Health Medical Center. Last night, we received 10 patients in a very short period of time to Denver Health Medical Center. We're able to rapidly triage these patients, identify which were the most seriously injured, and get them rapidly to the operating room, of which 4 patients required immediate emergent surgical intervention. Out of the 10 patients, we still have 5 patients remaining in the hospital. All patients, to my knowledge, are in fair condition. I would like to emphasize that while receiving 10 gunshot wound patients at the same time is a challenge for any medical center, Denver Health is the level 1 trauma center for both the city of Denver and the greater Rocky Mountain region. This is something that we drill and prepare for on a weekly and monthly basis. And I couldn't be more proud of the response of all of our paramedics, all of the emergency department staff, operative room staff, surgical surgeons, as well as our anesthesiologists and intensive care unit staff and all of the nurses. So thank you very much. I appreciate it. Turn it over to our public safety. Thank you. Thank you,
Doctor. Good morning. I'm Armando Saldate III, Executive Director of Public Safety here in Denver. I wanted to start by adding some words from Mayor Hancock. Mayor Hancock was at the game last night. I was keeping him briefed as we prepared for the game and the planning around our safety plan for the game through the night and early this morning. He was not able to attend this morning's briefing because he is on city business travel, but prior to getting on a plane, I did provide him an up-to-date briefing similar to what we're going through today. Also, I had the opportunity to brief Mayor-elect Mike Johnston this morning, also around the events of last night. All of us share the concern about this, the concern about gun violence in our community. You know, such a great event marred by some senseless acts of violence that we see far too common, conflict, needless conflict being settled, or where guns are produced and then gunfire and violence. But one thing that I wanted to assure everyone and I wanted to assure our community, we put everything in place to prevent serious things happening and for a safe event. These are the same types of plannings that we've done for Major League All-Star Games, what we've done for Avs Victory Parades, but we all know it's different and we learn from each one. Our response from each one has been different, and we try to learn, adapt our tactics to provide safe venues for that. We have been preparing as a city and as not only a police department, but a department of our public health paramedics, fire departments, DOTI, all sorts of city resources, a coordinated plan. We had hundreds of officers deployed last night for our plan, for the effectiveness of our plan. I received plenty of positive feedback of officers celebrating with our fans and the thousands that did celebrate peacefully. It was really great to see. It was great to see for our city. We were in a command post last night, Chief and I and his executive staff, but we were also represented by much more than just our departments. We had our local departments that were there that were helping us, assisting us, our sheriff department, who played a critical role for us, our fire department. We had it all, and unfortunately, we also had it on video, and we're gonna cue up the video to show you all here in a second of kind of the incident as it happened. But we were watching as it transpired, and as the chief and Commander Clark described, after midnight, where it devolved into some physical fights and then ultimately shootings. I'll tell you, it was a very chaotic scene. I've been in a lot of command posts through my 30 years in this business, and this was one of the more chaotic scenes, but it was also very well managed because we had every resource available and we were well coordinated. I was just giving compliments to our Denver Health partners about, I had two paramedic staff in front of me that were helping us. As victims were pouring in, you could only imagine the chaos that ensued around trying to count the number of victims we had and get the right emergent medical care. As you will see in the video, you're gonna see very heroic response by our Denver police officers. Unfortunately, we know what has happened when you have gunfire in a large crowd in Lodo. We've seen some very negative consequences of that. As I said, we've learned from our training and our tactics and our experience, and that response was evident. You saw police officers when gunfire and shots rang out, several shots. You will see our officers all run without hesitation towards those shots, rendering care immediately, life-saving care, and then our paramedics and fire officials getting there and doing life-saving care. I also got to commend the world-class care at Denver Health Emergency Room and the doctors there. I've spent far too often in the hospital lately with our own injured officers that have been shot in the line of duty. I see the incredible care and concern that the nurses, the staff, and the trauma care that they provide our citizens, and we are in good hands with them. And they truly perform life-altering and life-saving, and I'm truly thankful for that and that partnership. So right now we're gonna bring up Commander Clark. He's gonna show you some of our HALO footage. HALO is our overhead cameras, and as Commander Clark said, the investigation will also be looking for other like businesses and venues that have video, and obviously our community that has video, we hope to share those with you. We also have queued up for release some of these videos for you after this. So Commander Clark, thank you.
Okay, this video will be available for release as well, but what we're looking at right now is the view from my HALO camera. What we're looking at is 20th and Market Street. We're looking down. If you're looking down, you're in the 2000 block of Market Street. And specifically, there's officers in the intersection, and the specific area that we're looking towards where the shots occur is up by that vehicle. It's at the top of the screen there. This is about a 30-second clip. With no audio. So it's tough to make out specifically what's happening, but again, the action's occurring within feet, several feet just down the street from where the officers are. The multiple shots, at least 20 rounds, are fired. And then the vehicle that's there is where one of the firearms was recovered. Off camera, that's not captured by this halo, an officer officers can engage in a foot chase and pursue that individual to the location where they take him into custody down on Park Avenue. The other thing that we wanted to show was just to give a perspective. We're still working to understand the motive that ultimately led to the shooting in this case. There appears to be a drug nexus for this. There's several instances of fentanyl being recovered. Specifically at the end, we described four baggies or multiple baggies of bundled suspected fentanyl pills, and this was recovered at the scene, and we're still looking to determine who this is associated with. So one of the individuals who is at the hospital is in custody right now as an injured individual. I'm sorry, what was your second part?
How many of the people who were taken to the hospital were possible shooters?
So we're still working to understand what the involvement of everybody was at this point.
Last year we had celebrations for the Avalanche Parade, and there were maybe a couple hundred people in that exact same intersection, but it was a very different scene than what we had last night. Did you guys prepare in a different manner? Did you prepare in the exact same way? And if so, what was different? What went different?
Well, I think we prepared in very much a similar fashion, understanding that we would have a very similar sized crowd, and we did. And we saw many of the things that we saw consistent with the Avs win celebration. What we couldn't have planned for is a drug deal right in the middle of a celebration for an NBA championship. And so, thankfully, we were close enough to be able to respond quickly, take suspects into custody, and tend to those that were wounded. But I think that our planning was appropriate. We did account for things that we saw and experienced last year, as well as things that we may not have been able to see before.
Chief, can you expand on that? Mr. Clark talked about a drug nexus. I think mm-hmm. that's a drug deal. Can you talk more about what might have been the motive or what sparked this? Does it look like a drug deal? And can you please expand on that more?
Well, again, much more investigation to be done, but it certainly does appear to have been a drug nexus. There were quantities of cash. There was a large amount of drugs, as you can see. There does appear to be a collection of individuals who are engaged in some fashion. At some point in time, you begin to see an altercation, and I think at the tail end of that altercation is where shots were exchanged.
And so in that particular area that Mr. Clark pointed to, that's where it all started, that's where the fight was?
Correct.
And that's where the gunfight broke out?
Correct.
These were not people who were part of the celebration.
No. Our strong belief is that this was completely unassociated to the celebration.
In the video, we're seeing what looks to me an enormous amount of police officers at that intersection. How many officers are there that we can kind of see in that video at that intersection, and why was there such a concentration of them right there?
Well, we had a significant presence throughout the downtown area, being responsive to all of the challenges that we had in the downtown area. That particular location at 20th and Market, there had been a very large crowd, very boisterous crowd, peacefully protesting, but we wanted to be there and be a visible presence and also be responsive to anything that may happen. And so that's why you see the large collection of officers. And I would say that there were upwards of 100 officers in that immediate vicinity.
Chief, how does this change plans for the parade on Thursday? Like, how does this change the department's strategy to ensure safety?
Good question. So certainly, you know, we've been involved in celebration parades before. We're certainly aware of the potential for violence. We'll certainly be prepared for that. I think we have a significant plan. We continue to work with the city to develop that plan and make sure that we're prepared for any instance of violence or anything that goes awry. I think that we're just even more understanding of all of the challenges that could occur, and we'll be prepared to respond.
Chief, could you expand on that? There are families
yes.
who are now a little bit scared to bring their kids
certainly.
Downtown.
Certainly. Certainly. You know, I think the thing to focus on is that there were literally tens of thousands of people that were in the downtown area that were peacefully celebrating. And Unfortunately, there was a small group of individuals that chose to engage in some illegal behavior, and that went awry, and shots were exchanged. And so certainly we will be even more vigilant, you know, keeping a close eye on crowds and gatherings, and so I believe that we will be responsive to those challenges during the parade.
Can you just about 10 people who were injured, how many of those were just bystanders
nearby? I think our strong suspicion at this point is that 5 or 6 of those were completely innocent bystanders, and others had some level of involvement in the altercation.
Can you describe the type of firearms that were recovered?
They're all handguns.
Was this gang related?
I think it's a presumption at this point to assume that it was gang-related. I mean, I think that there is some gang nexus, but certainly we think that the primary motivation for this gathering was a drug deal.
You mentioned that the two people who were taken into custody or being questioned had previous offenses and were in the possession of a firearm when they shouldn't have been. Are they gang members, known gang members?
I'm not familiar with the gang involvement of those individuals that are currently in custody right now, but we do know that there are individuals involved in the incident that do have some gang involvement.
When do you think they might be charged?
I think that we're going to, very chaotic scene, lots of evidence to collect, lots of witnesses to interview. That work is underway as we speak, and so I can't give you a timeline when individuals will be charged, but certainly we will be looking to move that way very quickly.
Did any DPD officers fire the weapons?
No, absolutely not.
Do you think the person in the car with the gun in the floorboards, was that gun fired at the scene?
That weapon is being tested to determine whether or not it has been fired.
So right now it's only at least one person shooting?
Well, because of the different shell casings that were recovered at the scene, is pretty clear that there was more than one weapon that was fired.
Was that vehicle towed away?
Yes, it was.
Lodo is somewhere that we've seen multiple shootings happen, stabbings.
Yes.
You name it. Is that specific intersection, 20th and Market, where we've seen celebration shootings before outside the bars there, is this a specific area that is troublesome for you guys?
Well, certainly there have been a lot of violent incidents that have occurred there. I think that this is, a collection point for a lot of celebratory community members. There are a number of liquor establishments and at that particular location. So certainly it draws a crowd and they engage with each other at let out and after those establishments close. And so there's always the potential for violence. And I think, the two elephants in the room that I think it's important to address is that there's far too many guns that are in our communities today. We have a tremendous problem with fentanyl in our community today. Those were key elements in this particular situation.
It seems as almost though you knew something could happen there, having 100 officers in that intersection.
Certainly, and I think not long before that there were hundreds of individuals that were in the intersection there again, peacefully celebrating. I think that there's certainly the potential for danger anytime that there are large gatherings. I think that it's something that we should all be aware of and cognizant of. Again, as I mentioned, there are far too many guns in our community today, far too many individuals that act irresponsibly with weapons. And so I think that it is something that people need to be aware of and be cognizant of. It's certainly something that we are aware of and something that we focus on. Certainly we want to be respectful of people's opportunities to celebrate and be entertained in our downtown core, but that is something that is a concern.
Chief, do you know if the web building was hit, the web structure?
I don't believe so. I know that there was celebratory gunfire throughout the city. Whether or not that there were any significant structures that were struck, I don't believe so.
And looking ahead to the parade, talking about the dangers of large gatherings, mm-hmm. What would you want to say to people who are considering coming down, and can you keep them safe?
I think the answer to that is yes. We believe that we can keep them safe, that we'll have a significant presence throughout the parade route. I think that people will be safe. I would encourage people to come down with plans to peacefully celebrate. Certainly, if you become aware of troubling behavior or if you believe that someone has a weapon, I think that's something that we need to know immediately so that we can respond to that and secure that particular situation. But I anticipate this parade being very similar to last year's parade.
Knowing about that immediately, is that just
Yeah, I think that that's always a good tactic. Whether you see a suspicious package, whether you see someone that is handling a weapon, or you see what you believe to be a weapon in someone's possession underneath their clothing or in a container, that's something that we want to be able to look into. Well, as you see, we were steps away from this incident, and so our mere presence certainly did not stop the incident from occurring. And I can't speak to why those individuals felt emboldened enough to engage in that behavior very near to where officers were gathered. But certainly, I think just illustrates the considerable challenge we have in our community.
Thank you. How do you work with businesses?
One last question, okay?
Very fine.
Last question.
How did you work with businesses in that area to prepare them for this? And will that strategy be used for those along the parade route?
Yes, certainly. So we're a championship city, so we have been planning for a Nuggets win for a long time. And so we have been engaged with the businesses in the downtown area, making sure that they were familiar with our plan, understood our plan, and were able to help us in any way that they could. Certainly we understand the businesses down there that have cameras that could be useful to us in any kind of investigation. And the same thing will occur. We've known the date of the parade for a long time. And so we have been engaged in planning, and members of our community, members of our business community have been involved in that planning process as well.
Chief, one last question. Were your officers wearing body cameras? Were they activated? And would you consider releasing some of that video because of public interest in maybe capturing more information that we could spread out there?
So the simple answer to all of those is yes. All of our officers are outfitted with body cameras. All of our officers had their body cameras activated because of the environment that was going on down there. And certainly, if we can identify relevant pieces of video that we'd like to release, just to give greater context to the situation that was going on, we'll do that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so as Chief Thomas indicated, we have been planning in that. Let me explain who the we is. The we is not only police, Department of Safety, fire, obviously our fire contingent and our Denver Health Paramedic Division, but also our Dottie teams, our business partners, our Downtown Denver Partnership, Visit Denver, key partners like that, our business community in providing that. We are working. We've been working for quite some time to plan this, our Office of Special Events and the Mayor's Office. So it's a large gathering. Well, what we will do now, if there's going to be any different, obviously we're going to rethink and look at things to be doubly sure, especially around crowd management, crowd control, and suspicious behaviors. But we will be well staffed. That's a big thing. As we continue to grapple with our staffing, we've had short staffing for some time since COVID, but we're working through that. We have a lot of folks on extra duty, extra time, overtime coming out to do that. So we'll be well staffed and well positioned. We'll have our command post and likely have our emergency operations center activated as well, which brings all people to bear, monitoring halo cameras and all sorts of things. But I also want to reiterate, community members are our best eyes and ears. You all know when you see something, you say something, you report it. So if you see something, you see some undesirable behavior, you see suspicious activity, please report it. It's our intention, and my confidence is that it'll be a very safe event. I'll have my own family there, so I hope that it'll be a very safe event for all, and we're preparing for that.
How different is it to have an event that large in the morning versus at
Well, it is. It's different, you know, night and day just brings a whole different element and environment. Also, you know, I don't think we're going to have the drinking, folks drinking all throughout, and we all know what sometimes drunken behavior can do to exaggerate some of these things. So hopefully we won't deal with some of those same things, but yeah, obviously a daytime, and I think this will be kicking off around 10 a.m. to around 1 p.m. So I think hopefully that'll add better environment as well.
A follow-up question for Dr. Campion, please, if you could. Is it Campion? Is that the way you pronounce it? Just on the nature of the wounds, I don't know what you might be able to talk about how serious the injuries were. You talked that they're in fair condition. Can you tell us just generally, hit the ankle, the head, or the chest, or can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I think, you know, based on patient safety, it'd be inappropriate to share specific details, but I think it's safe to say that every patient that went to the operating room had serious and life-threatening injuries.
How many surgeries might have been going on at one time, and how many surgery rooms do you have?
Yes, we have 12 operating rooms in the main hospital at Denver Health, and we had four concurrent operations for this event, and there was an unrelated gun violence victim who was also being operated on. So we had five operating rooms running at the same time.
Was that last thing you just mentioned from the team and the other shooting last night?
I'm sorry, I'm not aware of where that victim was specifically from.